I didn't think that would get you.
No, I thought you were going to say something.
I just did the same as you. Just went,
oh, okay. No, I thought you were saying something. My bad.
Like a sheep getting electrified.
Is that what?
Oh. comes in pints.
So do I.
Welcome to another episode of the Miles Offside Podcast, where we talk a little bit of football and a whole lot of nonsense. My name is Oscar Puente, also known as Footy From Afar, and with me, as always, are my co-hosts, Mr. 100% Chuck Bailey and Super Producer Ian Stimson.
And for once, there is a little bit of football that we can talk about.
Yeah, hell yeah. Bundesliga's back. Korean League, right? Korea still
Oh, well,
playing?
Yeah, no, we are the official K-League podcast, yeah.
Was yes. K-League still a thing? They had a very small, honeymoon period of everyone going, oh, there's football, K-League's back, and all of a sudden, like, oh, get away, Europe.
Yeah.
Who says the public want Brexit?
The public, apparently.
No. The public did, yeah. I'm pretty sure there was a vote on that one. So we had a round of the bluffer that was not recorded, but was quite fun yesterday, right, with the Patreons?
But that was yesterday, wasn't it? I don't remember what days are. I just remember that you won again. You win everything.
That's not true. I didn't. Well, oh, actually, speaking of,
God.
I fucking listened back to our episode last week, and we very clearly said at the beginning that if either Chuck or I won the week, we were going to be crowned champions. And then, of course, Chuck snuck in there before anything and was like, well, we had a tie, actually, so we got to go to a tiebreaker before anybody has a chance to notice. And yeah. I got to make sure that Oscar doesn't win. And then Ian ended up with the quote-unquote title.
No, but hang on. Yeah. You were there. You had the ability at the time to go, an hour ago, I said something different.
Yeah.
But because your mind doesn't work, so you can do Pixar movies in order, but when it comes to remembering a conversation we had an hour ago, you just forgot. I win, pod canon. That's how it goes.
I don't accept it. Also, private second class is indeed a thing, as verified by military ranks.
I mean, I went on the official US Army website. It's not there. Like, it doesn't exist. I went on the Department of Defense website. It doesn't exist. We argued about this. You're wrong. You just
highly contested.
A, this isn't a democracy. B, if it was a democracy, 2-1.
I win.
Well, we got to let Ian have the win.
He's not got long left.
No, it's true. I mean, look.
In life?
Yeah, because you're old. It's an old joke.
Good Lord.
All right, well, let's kick it off as we always do, as we haven't done in many months, but we're very excited to again. And that is with
rapid fire news.
The jingle might have been deleted.
You could always just make a new one. That's the super and super producer. Our top story this evening. That's right. Hearts have been relegated from the Scottish Premier League. That's the big story everybody's talking about this week. Yep. Celtic have been confirmed as Scottish champions for the 9th season in a row. And Hearts have been relegated after the Scottish Premier League. Or the Scottish SPFL. What does it PFL stand for?
Premier Football League.
Our Scottish Premier Football League has voted to end the season.
League. Premier Fantasy League.
The Scottish Professional Football League.
Okay.
Oscar, without just saying Scotland, where do Hearts play?
Glasgow?
Point to Chuck.
Edinburgh? Where do they play? I'm waiting.
Edinburgh. They play in Edinburgh, yeah.
I may have driven past their stadium, actually.
Stadium. Whatever. That's a bit.
Both had the same joke there. Oh, dear.
Nothing if not consistent. One of the other leagues did also vote to end their season, and that is the Belgian League. Club Bruges have been declared the champions.
Well, that was a saga that was going on for so long. Genk, that's a Belgian team.
And Gent. Yeah, they have a Genk and a Gent.
Yeah. Only an idiot would mistake those two.
I'm sure I've done it at some point.
Liverpool fan. The Liverpool fans.
Oh, yeah.
Remember? They bought the wrong tickets.
Oh. Yeah.
They didn't check and then went to a restaurant
God.
And didn't know where it was.
I just asked someone. Didn't check the smartphones at any... Yeah, of course.
Yeah, oh, wankers.
At a time where you could just be so frivolous about international transport.
I know, right?
What a luxury we can ill afford these days. No.
Ill. Emphasis on ill.
Imagine just being somewhere and not having to stay inside. God, what an age we live in. Imagine also being relegated from the Scottish League.
I literally can't.
How shit have you got to be?
Do they? I guess they have a second division then, that means, by
logic. Just like you hate the English pyramid, there's a Scottish pyramid as well.
Yeah.
Does it have 25 levels? Two I can tolerate.
Probably about 6, 7, I don't know.
That seems like too much.
Once you get into places called Cowden Beath, you kind of start to get a bit ridiculous.
Is that Ian's hometown?
Stenhouse Muir.
I mean, to be fair, Oscar, these levels of the pyramid don't exist to satisfy a soccer fan in Rhode Island. Like, they're not for you. Don't worry about them.
It's not for you. Stop watching. Stop looking.
All right. Fair enough. That is a thing that Emily and I love to say is when people get mad about things. Like, we were watching a documentary about rap, the history of rap, and there was just this, like, really angry middle-aged white lady in the early 90s being like, I found a rap CD and it offended me at Walmart. And
it's like, not bitch, for lady, you.
It's not for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's just not for you, and that's okay. So you know what? You saying that to me, I'm having a moment of self-reflection. This is a time for growth. This is a time to reevaluate your priorities. And yeah, all right, it's not for me. Have your pyramid. Fine.
Isn't it good that Rangers get really pissed off about not winning the Scottish Premier League a few weeks before they wouldn't have won it in the first place?
Oh, well, anytime Steven Gerrard gets to just miss out on a trophy again, good for me.
Yeah, it is that time of year where he just misses out on trophies. So.
Oh, how we laugh.
Just enjoy Rangers fans just getting indignant about, no, we should void the season properly because Celtic haven't won it. Yeah, but they were going to just... Chill your boots.
Yeah. How many asterisks do you want?
Yeah.
They've won it for 10 years in a row.
Yeah.
9, sir. Thank you very much. Don't get ahead of yourself.
Literally just kicking the can down the road. Don't worry
All
about
of a
it.
Sudden, he starts caring. He doesn't care about the English football pyramid, but he cares about the Scottish Premier League.
You know, the numbers. Once There's you bring numbers involved. In and you're disrespecting the number 10 by equating it with the number 9, now I'm offended, okay? It's
Rapid
pretty simple.
Fire news.
quickly settled back into our old tropes.
Yeah, doesn't this feel great? Doesn't this feel really great?
Yeah, it does feel good, because we finally actually got some listener numbers for the last one, now that everyone's going back to work and risking their lives on public transport that they're not supposed to, but they are supposed to go on, but they can't.
Yeah. Hello, commuters, with your computers.
With your computers.
Niche Alan Partridge for you there, Oscar.
I was going to say, that must be an Alan Partridge thing. Yeah. Always is. When you guys just start laughing and giggling, and I'm like, I don't know what that was. It was Alan Partridge, 90% of the time.
You've had so much time, you could have sat and watched all of it.
Like, literally so much time. You actively choose not to watch it.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
But just get involved.
Yeah. It's okay.
Well, what's the day today where he does his guide to the USA World Cup 94? It's absolutely brilliant.
Goal!
So good. And there's some American in there to keep you interested.
Yeah.
You're acting like I like Americans
What's
anymore
the next
than
news
I like English
story?
People.
Just segue.
I'm just trying to keep this going.
Just so segue.
Yeah. Okay. Next story. League One clubs should follow League Two and end their season, says Rochdale chief executive. David Bottomley wants fellow League One clubs to end the season and not make decisions stemming from financial greed. Is it Rochdale or Rockdale? Did I say the wrong thing there?
No, no, no. I was laughing at Bottomley, so... Oh.
No decision has been made in the third tier, but 6 clubs have said they are determined to complete their fixtures prior to further discussion.
Peterborough.
Are you in the evil group, Ian?
Yeah, I think we might be, mate.
Are you the baddies?
I think we're the baddies. Where this is concerned, we are definitely the baddies. Dara's been riling everybody up. To try and... obviously, it's all about the sporting integrity of League One, Chuck. It's nothing to do with the fact that we were in with a shout of promotion. It's about the sporting integrity of the game. And it turns out a few other clubs near the top have also suddenly become worried about the sporting integrity of League One. So, yeah, we're voting or whatever. We're sort of vocally saying that we need the season to keep going. League Two, though, have unanimously voted to end their season. Now, that doesn't mean it's going to happen, because it still needs to be ratified. It's more of a like indicative vote of what they want to do. Because until League One sort out what they want to do, because League Two have said they want to do it with promotion still happening, but no relegation.
What league, and it, yeah. genuinely, because I've forgotten now, what league are Bolton and Bury in?
Well, Bury were in League One.
Right.
And they obviously have no longer exist. So there is, that's another thing. There is a place in League One that needs to be taken up somehow. So
but
do
it's
we
also
relegate?
One less team to get relegated from that league.
Do we relegate one less person from League One? One less team, sorry, from League One?
Or promote one more from below.
Or promote one more from below. All that seems to happen is they have meetings about when they're going to have the next meeting. And
That is what it seems like. Every time I read a headline, I'm like,
yeah,
a meeting in 2 weeks about a meeting in 3 weeks. But it is funny how the leagues like Scotland and Belgium and League Two are like, and who else was it?
The French League.
Greece, maybe? The French League. Well, French League actually less
Netherlands.
In this vote. Yeah, but like, oh, let's vote to end it because we care about player safety and we care about...
They are also, I will just say again, they are also very uncompetitive leagues.
Sure, but Germany is, and they're still back. And then the leagues that have big TV contracts and huge amounts of money involved, like League One with promotion, they're like, no, you know what? Like, let's, I don't know about this. Like, it could be safe, right? It could totally be safe. If you just don't celebrate with each other, don't high-five each other, it'll be fine. Come on.
Come on.
Yeah.
Ah. It's a tricky one, isn't it? The fashion seems to be at the minute for not voiding entirely, but using some sort of metric, be it let's just call it what it is now, or let's do points per game, because I think that's what League Two have said. They want to do an unweighted, very simple points per game thing, which would mean I think Swindon would finish top, even though they're not top at the minute, which is interesting. So, the fashion seems to be very much for not playing anymore, but still awarding something, which does open up legal issues. I don't know. It's a tricky one.
I think
one.
No matter what, it's a mess.
Oh, a total mess. No one can be happy with everything, you know.
I just think the weird thing is that obviously you have to, like, you know, we've spoken about contracts ending in the summer of players, and then that they making it difficult. But there's kind of ways around that with temporary contracts, etc.
There should be, yeah.
You don't know when you're going to be able to start the next season. So what happens with all of the players anyway? So if, let's say, all football was voided now, everywhere, they all decided because it's going to be 6 to 12 months until we get, like, a vaccine. And now, obviously, within that, if you don't see football as a business, as a person that owns a hairdresser's or a supermarket or an office or whatever... Like, you wouldn't be able to do that, and those would gradually go back. But football, because of the competitive nature of it and the sport and entertainment element, it's seen as frivolous. Like, what happens to all those players? What happens to all those guys that they aren't allowed to meet up and train? They aren't going to, you know, go get a job at Sainsbury's.
You imagine?
You know, you presume...
Just Olivier Giroud is, like, bagging your groceries, and you're like...
I would go to that supermarket every fucking day.
Yeah, you can charge me double for that.
Yeah, but, you know, would you expect the Cubs to keep... paying all the players? How do the players stay in their houses? What do they do? You know, just to kind of take it on a slightly different tangent, that if no football happens for a year, it's not just about the clubs folding.
Well, yeah, like, what happens to the industry?
Like, yes, the players earn a lot of money, like a certain amount, but however, everything is scalable, right?
Sure, but like there was reports that like the Premier League as a collective has $3.5 billion, I think.
Yeah, that was amazing. The cash reserves could keep the lower leagues going for ages.
There are payments that are going down. Like they've not kept quiet about that. There is money going down to the lower league clubs.
There is,
There is anyway, regardless of this, there's money that goes down to them.
I just think when like Steve Bruce comes out, Troy Deeney, Grant Hanley, Sergio Aguero, Raheem Sterling, Tammy Abraham, all these players are coming out and being like, listen, I don't want to put my family at risk. I'm like, literally, I have quotes from Troy Deeney in front of me because they had a meeting with the players union last week. And a bunch of players came out with quotes afterwards. And he said, I'm not even talking about football. I'm talking about my family's health. I feel that if I'm not looking after my family, then I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to put my family at risk. What are they going to do? Take money off me? I've been broke before. So it doesn't bother me.
But that's no different to any organization or job. If you put aside the fact that it's an entertainment industry, let's say. If you put that aside... But that's
such a huge thing to put aside.
No, but if you just say that it is a business, of course, at the moment, they will focus... And this is going to sound really bad because I'm not the kind of person that wants to force people back to work. Far from it. I think it should be safe. Within everything, there are players like Troy Deeney, etc. And I think everyone is concerned for the safety of their family. Everybody is. But
sure.
At the same time, there are lots of people that are like footballers or anyone that does a job that like, I'd really like to be able to go back to work. Especially something like football, because it's a dream for a lot of these players to be able to do it. And it's and you feel like, especially when you're in a season, you know, Andros Townsend has been saying like he really, really wants to go back and start playing again. That's not to say that he's going to cast aside all things of safety. I just think that there are layers and it's, you know, having the meetings with the players union, they're probably going to be the same as any workforce for any job. They're like, of course we're happy to go back. No, we don't want to just sit back and claim our furlough pay or, you know, effectively our benefits now. We actually want to go and do something. It's the same everywhere, but you just want to make sure that when you do go back, it's safe.
Right, and I think that's the key issue, though, because, like, how safe is a contact sport? That's entirely, like, there's no social distancing while you're playing the game. You're sweating all over each other. Like, that's just the nature of the game. Like, what are they going to change the laws that you have to stay 6 feet away at all times?
I think it's really important what Chuck said, though, in that there's no black and white on this situation. Because we, no. on the show I work on, we had Troy Deeney on today. And via Skype, obviously. And, like, he was saying, he's got a kid who has breathing difficulties, who has chest problems.
Mm.
Now, he is all in favour of this first phase of this project restart that started, which is groups of, I think, five players at a time going into training, fully socially distanced, no contact to start with. But then he said his concerns really come in on like phase two and three when they're talking about bringing larger groups of players in and then ultimately having contact.
Especially when 80% of his play is elbowing people in the face.
Yeah, full of contact. Right in the nose. Yeah. Absolutely. So it's not black and white, even with someone who, like Troy Deeney, like, you know, he's happy to sort of go back to this first stage of training.
Yeah.
But, you know, then it becomes very, very tricky to sort of... I mean, like we've said it before, you can test someone, well... Unless you get a negative test immediately before a game or a training session, how sure can you be that they're not carrying it?
Amount of tests that they're using, and not to get like too big picture about it, or even bring my own American like issues with our lack of testing and lack of availability with that, but they purchased 40,000 tests,
yeah,
just for the players and staff to be able to come in every day and get tested when they do, because that was like where I was going to transition to next, like tomorrow. Clubs in the Premier League are starting to train in small groups. Today, the La Liga clubs went back and they're training in groups of five, socially distant, whatever. Yeah. Also, like, the amount of resources that these people are using that could be used elsewhere in the world. I forget which player it said, but it was like, we're taking these tests away from, like, actual healthcare workers, whether in the UK or other parts of the world, like...
But that's a government allocation issue. I'm sorry. That's not a...
Yeah.
Like, people like Premier League teams, you should be... And we've said this before. You should be entitled to be able to buy a test for yourself. You simply can. But if the government's not going to provide it for those people that are the front line, the key workers, the whatever the buzzword they want to put on it, but then also fuck them over everywhere, left, right and centre, that's their issue. That's in no way. If the tests are available to buy and you can buy them... And you can therefore help that company to make more and up their production. If the government's just not allocating it in these key areas, like that's a fuck up on a different level.
Yeah. I mean, there's two things there as well, because we've got domestically in the UK at the minute, there is the capacity for testing that anyone over the age of five now who's got symptoms can get a test. So, like, we haven't got a problem with capacity for testing in this country. What you said, Oscar, was the first time I've actually thought about internationally maybe we should be thinking about, you know, sending some of those tests abroad, perhaps, for countries that haven't got them. But that's the first time I've thought of that. But domestically, we are we are okay.
Yeah, yeah, that's probably me bringing my own, like, American issues into it.
And I mean, we did sell a shitload of stuff abroad at the start of this because our government sat on their hands and gave money to...
Yes, we've sent tests and PPE to the USA, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. We sent all our stuff away because these people were like, look, we've got it and you're not going to have it on us. And then we sent out loads of tests to people that ended up going in the bin because they never picked up the at-home testing kits. So they expired and people had to throw them in the bin. So
still counts.
Hashtag political.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah.
Why
good
not?
Good stuff.
Rapid fire news.
Whatever.
Well, it's obviously a very complicated situation and there's arguments on all sides. But I think, at least for me, at the end of the day, the safety thing is what gets me. And that, like, the way the game is played, like you said, Ian, it's one thing to train and it's a whole nother thing to, like, actually be having games. And the way that the game, like, the very essence and nature of the game makes it an inherently unsafe or less safe activity compared to, like, you know, someone stocking shelves at a supermarket.
Yeah.
There's that weird punishment kind of thing we spoke about before with Italian football teams, where there will be times where, like, if they're having a really shit run or there's some sort of dissent or et cetera in the team, that they get made to stay at the training ground. Now, I'm not saying that all the players stay at the training ground the whole time, but let's say before a game, there's like a 3-day period where then that's when they get their training done to then play a game. So you kind of get tested at the start of that 3-day period. You're in isolation then. It brings with it all kinds of issues, etc.
Yeah, but it's such a complicated thing, man.
But the complications are similar no matter what job you do. And ultimately in a football stadium ideal, it can be closed in that there's no other people coming from the outside. You know, if you work in an office, you could have postmen or visitors. In my profession, I work in restaurants. I can't control what guest comes through the door. We're talking about our PPE and doing temperature checks on our staff, etc. But we can't stand at the door and temperature check guests from coming in.
Right.
The three of us have got completely different jobs from each other, and all of our jobs have changed unimaginably from a few months ago. So everyone has to change, you know. So I mean, I'm not saying football has to go ahead by any means, but the Premier League are going to be watching what happens with the Bundesliga very closely to see if they can learn anything,
especially in a country that's had their controls quite well.
Yeah, because Germany's done a much better job.
Yeah, it's not saying much compared to our two countries, no. Yes, they...
Yeah. I guess what they could do, just thinking out loud, is do like an Olympics type thing where they set up a village.
Don't talk to me about fucking Olympics.
Set up like a Premier League Olympic style village where the players live for a month. They finish out the season like in actual isolation from the rest of society. Anyone who's required to like be part of that whole system, you know, maybe you pay them extra, right? Because they're leaving their families for a month or whatever. And then you get it done that way. Like, that seems somewhat feasible. I don't know.
Yeah, it's good. There's only going to have to be creative solutions to this, which is a bizarre problem. I mean, as I say, every profession has had to have some sort of mad creative solution to how they continue to work. But,
well, speaking of creative solutions, that's a perfect out to this rather tricky conversation. FC Seoul apologizes for their creative solution to having fans in the stands at their game because they used a bunch of sex dolls.
Not a problem.
How do you really think the players were that bothered when they were like, you know, at the corner of their eye, they saw some seats? Like, do you think that was more of a distraction than out of their corner of an eye seeing, holy fuck.
What are you doing out of my attic?
Yeah. Jenny, what are you doing here?
Did they set them all to vibrate so it generated some noise around the stadium?
Grim.
So the club is, you know, obviously denying that they knew they were sex dolls. They were sold to them as quote-unquote premium mannequins.
Yeah. At what point when they were blowing them up did they not realize?
No, these are like the premium ones. These are the ones that like have wigs and eyelashes and shit. Like, it's too far. It's too much. But so here, let me read the quotes from the BBC for you. Before the match, a company called Dalcom offered to fill some of the empty seats, and the club agreed. In total, there were 30 mannequins, 28 of them female and 2 of them male.
30. So their solution to fill, to make a stadium feel less empty, was to put 30 sex dolls in it.
Oh, no, yeah, socially distanced sex dolls.
There are so many holes. So many holes to pick in this.
About 90.
Don't pick holes in it. That's the last thing you want to do.
Oh, boy.
Now, I've got a quote as well, because fans watching the match on television took to social media, and one of them said, "Just look at their breasts. They were 4 times bigger than those of normal mannequins." It's your first clue, isn't it? Fucking hell. I just love that. Someone's going on Twitter going, "Look, these tits don't look right. No, nope. Not happy with this.
Going to have to call someone about these. It's too big. I'm offended.
Too big."
Well, that's the thing with live TV. You can pause and you can check these things.
I think I've got that sex doll. So rewinded.
Or you can find out what you need to complete the set.
Well, yeah. Yeah, exactly. It's like, what, like Panini stickers? So we're just going through, going, got, need that one.
I do appreciate, like, on a 2020 Stay Woke level, that they did have 2 male sex dolls, you know, just to be inclusive. They got the 28 female and the 2 male, because who knows what people like? I'm not assuming, right?
Yeah.
You know, you want to go in the stands afterwards and celebrate your win. Different strokes for different folks.
Fucking male sex doll with a massive fucking boner. Seems a bit weird. I don't know.
He's very excited that football is back, Ian. Just very excited.
We all are. We all are.
Speaking of, we'll briefly touch on this. We're not going to become a Bundesliga pod by any means whatsoever. But there was Bundesliga this week. Your boy Erling Haaland scoring the first goal of 2020 2.0, as I put it on Twitter. 4-0 to Dortmund. Big, big win to kick off the restarted, for however long this ends up lasting, Bundesliga season. That was pretty fun to watch.
Imagine that, being a player that you want to come back and you're like, right, big for Schalke, like big derby game against Dortmund, coming back. Huge. Oh,
yeah, I love all the tweets. I think Gary Lineker among, and there was, you know, a million other ones, but saying, did Schalke forget that the 0-4 in their name has nothing to do with what the scoreline should be?
How very
but
droll.
I bring up the Bundesliga just because, cue up the jingle.
Ooh, they're better than they ought to be.
Bürnley of the week.
I am so desperate to give this out. We have Bürnley of the week. Or should I say Berlinley of the week. Hertha Berlin 3, Hoffenheim 0.
Berlinley of the Vodka!
Hoffenheim 2.8 on XG, scoring 0. To Burnley's 1.5, scoring 3. So, did I say Burnley?
To Burnley. You actually said Burnley then.
Hertha Burnley getting a 3-0 victory.
Hertha Burnley won 3-0. Oh my god. Is that the hipster one? Is that the hipster one that everyone's following?
Which one did you pick?
Borussia Mönchengladbach.
And that must be the hipster one, clearly. They won 3-1, so that was a good choice. Well, that's a dangerous amount of football for 1 week, so let's move on to our main segment, which is what?
Well, this comes to us. So, as you know, we have a Patreon, patreon.com/milesoffsidepod. And if you come aboard at the producer level, then you get to select a topic for a pod. Now, producer Nate Whitten had been commenting about the kind of meme that's been going around on social media while the football's been off, of guys asking their girlfriends to write out a team on paper. So, you know, various hilarities ensue and blah, 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 blah. And we made our women do it, but we'll save that one for later.
We made our women do it.
We made our women, because they have nothing better to do than to contribute to
this. Yeah, as if it's not bad enough to put up with us full time.
I know. So we thought, as a kind of offshoot of that, because we know less football than our ladies, they should really just do this pod themselves. Yeah. So we thought we'd kind of come up with our own 11 players and therefore use that to create a MOP 11.
Like a favourite team, yeah.
Yeah, a favourite. We decided, well, Oscar kind of decided that we wouldn't go obvious, i.e. we're not going to put Messi, we're not going to put Ronaldo.
Not necessarily the best.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just the players that speak to your heart.
Yeah. Exactly.
Ah, oh, that's a lovely way of putting it. I should probably change a lot of things. It's been so long, I couldn't even remember the current Palace team. So I figured that what we do is kind of go around and speak a little bit about the players and have a chat and decide between ourselves how we build this team. We'll see what formation we end up with or whatever. Yeah,
this could get really tricky really quickly.
Yeah, this could be brilliant. Absolutely. So let's hand over to the reigning Bluff champion, Mr. Ian Stimson himself, to start off with who's going to be in nets. That is goalkeeper for our abroad listeners.
So my goalkeepers, I say goalkeepers because I've got two choices. Now,
right.
I think
First of all, that's not how a football team works. I know it's been a long time.
No. I'm aware of this, but I'm going to narrow. I think I'm falling on one side of this, but I thought I'd just bring them both to the table so as you can think about
it. Well,
yourselves.
I've got a few honourable mentions
for
various positions, so that's fine, afterwards.
So
but
they're very much sort of two sides of different coin. So
one saves and one doesn't?
No, more personality wise. Because the first one. No, I didn't know. The first one I've gone for is Mark Bosnich. So.
Wow.
Yeah. So he was decent. He had long stints at top clubs.
Manchester United.
Clubs. It was with Man United, but Aston Villa, they were a top club for a while.
At that time, they were up there.
He did all right, but it's mainly. It's mainly his off-field life, which is what I want him. So
you mean his battle with obesity while still being a goalkeeper?
Oh, it's coming. So he really took that sort of like laddie image of a 90s footballer and ran with it in a big way.
He was Australian.
Exactly. He was described by Alex Ferguson as a terrible professional. So he would turn up for training 3 hours late and afterwards be overheard on his mobile phone like audibly ordering a Chinese takeaway for when he got home.
A man after our own hearts, for sure.
Absolutely. Oh, he's done a little bit of work on the training field, got to get a Chinese takeaway in for when I get home. He had trouble getting his working visa to work in the UK. So he married an English woman, insisted that they were in love, and after 2 years of marriage, the Home Office granted him leave to remain in the UK, and then 3 months later the marriage was over. He went out with model Sophie Anderton, and he would match her line for line in the cocaine stakes, which is fine if you're a supermodel, but if you're a professional footballer, it's not...
See, I don't know. Like, judging by the size of him, like, if he was sustaining a hefty cocaine habit, like...
Balance it out.
That just means he was eating a fuckload more than you
exactly.
even think.
Exactly. He made a sex tape with Dwight York and two women where he was wearing a dress and being whipped and having his toes sucked.
Where would one find...
I don't know. I haven't watched it. I don't know if it's
available.
It was leaked.
He hasn't watched it this week.
Yeah. No,
okay.
Exactly. It's on VHS in the back. And also there was some unpleasantness with a Nazi salute to some Tottenham fans. But
I'm going to go ahead and veto this for so many reasons. He is not going to be our keeper.
Your second choice?
Yeah.
Understood. So the other side of that coin is...
off to a good start here, by the way. Let's bring up a Nazi. That's how we want to start this segment.
I'll just cross out Wayne Hennessy from mine.
Just wait till he brings up Adam Johnson for later, right, Ian?
Jesus.
How did you pick these guys?
Nailed down, centre mid.
Listen, the other one is Neville Southall, MBE. Consummate professional. Played in goal for Everton for 16.
Why? It says a lot about you that you pick the goalkeepers with expanding waistlines.
Yeah, absolutely.
And not, for the record, Peterborough's greatest ever player and one of the greatest players to ever play for England.
David Seaman, yeah.
Whose name is Seaman? That's perfectly on brand for us. Like, what are you doing?
Well, incidentally, that was the first pick on my wife's team. But anyway, Neville Southall played for Everton for 16 seasons. Cat-like reflexes before he put all the weight on. Mm. Teetotal. Dedicated his life to improving his game. Was a bit of a loner, but just was dedicated to football. And since he's retired and that, he uses his profile now to support good causes. He's handed over his Twitter account to like LGBTQ groups and sex worker charities. Like, he's really sort of on the side of the disenfranchised in life, and has done a tremendous amount for the pie industry. But Neville South was a good guy and he was a great player. And I've only just realised since you've said it that yes, I've picked two fatties. I didn't.
But you did go fair enough for the two sides of the coin there.
And I was going on the side of Southall. I just wanted to mention Bosnich because my first thought was let's get a party boy. But then I was like, you know,
I'm pretty sure there'll be plenty of time for party boys later.
Good.
But in a kind of similar vein and straight down the middle, and funnily enough, you mentioned it, I went with Kelly Stimson. And I put as my goalkeeper for this, because I kind of went with, like, I wanted to, you know, you joke about me being a hipster, whatever, you but I wanted to make sure it was players, like, during my lifetime that I could have actually, like, seen and experienced and whatever. And the man, David Seaman, MBE as well, like...
Lovely.
He was fantastic. Like, he played for Arsenal and you didn't hate him.
True.
He won the Premier League twice. He won the old First Division. He used to save penalties. As an England goalkeeper, saved penalties, including the one against Scotland. McAllister steps up, and it wasn't a particularly good penalty, but Seaman still did it, and then it led to the greatest goal in England history. He had a moustache and a ponytail, and his name was Seaman. And you didn't giggle about any of those things because he was just...
And that Euro 96 kit as well, Seaman.
You wanted the goalkeeper kit.
I'm not a kit man. You know, I don't get into kits and boots and stuff, but that kit was absolutely brilliant. Just loved it.
Absolutely fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. He saved... I even looked it up. He was good at penalties. He, in the Premier League, he faced 22 penalties and he saved 7 of them. So like 1 in 3 penalties.
That's decent, yeah.
He's one of the best penalty stoppers ever. Played 4 tournaments for England. Obviously Arsenal, so he won the FA Cup a load of times.
And ex-Peterborough.
Ex-Peterborough. He's a lovely northerner. I've met him. He's just a great guy. Just a lovely, unassuming guy. And yes, so I put forward that David Seaman should be the goalkeeper for our joint 11.
Well, I suspect that I'm going to get outvoted on that, but having never seen David Seaman, I cannot in good conscience vote for him. Okay. And you guys can probably assume who I put.
Peter Cech.
And that is the one, the only Petr Cech. Yeah, speaking of amazing penalty records.
Can I just ask one second, how many Chelsea players am I going to have to veto in this thing?
Only like half my team. I tried to be as impartial as I could. You know, Cech. I mean, he's Cech and his name is Cech. He wears a helmet. He's amazing at saving penalties. He plays the drums. and just genuinely a super nice guy. He's trying to be a professional hockey player now, although who knows if that's still going on. But he did post a video of him training in his basement with hockey stuff on. And also probably the greatest Premier League goalkeeper of all time. It's him or Van der Sar.
Yeah, the problem is, like, even though I suggested a goalkeeper that played for Arsenal, like, he killed himself by going to Arsenal. Like, he was a great penalty saver until he went to Arsenal.
Yeah.
He was a great shot stopper until he went to Arsenal. He could claim the ball in the box until he went to Arsenal. Like, why did he do that to himself? Why didn't he just...
His family wanted to stay in London, and Chelsea weren't going to play him anymore.
He could have just stopped.
We keep giving our, like, discarded players whose families want to stay in London to Arsenal. Like, that's a pattern emerging. We take Arsenal's good players as they're about to enter their prime so that those players can win titles with us. And then we ship off our old aging players to Arsenal so that they can, you know, kind of like the MLS, like a retirement league.
Yeah. I mean, that's not exclusively a Chelsea thing. There's a lot of clubs that buy players off Arsenal just before they hit their prime.
Yeah. City, too, have done that quite a few times.
Yeah. Robin Van Persie.
Oh, yeah. That's right. He went to go win a title somewhere else. Lots of people have to leave Arsenal so they can go get trophies. But anyway, so we're just going to go Seaman here, right? I'll concede that because he's a posh player, the greatest posh player. He's English. You guys are English. And Chuck brought him up. Like, I assumed it would be Ian that brought him up, but the fact that it was Chuck,
yeah,
I'm like, hey,
I didn't want to go route one.
I'm pretty outnumbered here, so.
Yeah, I am worried slightly in this that a lot of mine and Ian's will be the same. So I was
yeah,
quite
there
glad.
Might be some crossover. Yeah.
Cool. So I'm glad I put thought into this. That'll be fun.
We're going David Seaman, aren't we?
Yeah, we're going David Seaman at the back.
David Seaman.
But shout out, much love to Petr Cech, and all our Chelsea fan listeners are grinding their teeth.
Goalkeeper. Oh, no, yeah. I will concede that 100%, sir. And just like Seaman, will concede long-range shots against Ronaldinho.
If I might just 1 second to wax poetical about Petr Cech on that Champions League final, because I think that Drogba gets all the love, but I have said on multiple occasions to Chelsea fans that I know that I think Petr Cech actually had the biggest hand in us winning that title, even more than Drogba did.
I mean, he should have big hands. He's a goalkeeper.
Ew.
Come on.
Come on. You keep setting him up. I'll keep knocking him down. All right, so that's our shot stopper. I'm happy with that. Safe hands, Seaman. And then we'll go to our defence. So are we going to go... I'm going to assume with this that we all probably got ahead of ourselves and went a bit glamorous, or at least I did, and picked six players who probably played as striker. So are we going four at the back?
Yeah. I have four at the back in mind.
Yeah, I do as well.
Okay, so let's go with your first defender, Oscar. I'll leave it up to you whether you want to start at the right or at the left.
I'll start at the right so that we can go to a non-Chelsea pick, just to get us going.
Oh, good. The only one.
And that is Philipp Lahm at right back. Probably Germany's, at least since I've been alive, best defender. You know, Robertson or Trent before Robertson and Trent were themselves. A right back so good that Pep played him at left back and then at central midfield because he just had such a varied skill set. He was so creative, an amazing passer, amazing defender. First goal of the 2006 World Cup, one of my favorite goals. And that goal was the day that I was like, you know what? This is way too much fucking fun. I need to start watching soccer more than once every 4 years. I'm going to put in the effort to start watching this shit regularly. And it was Philipp Lahm's goal against Costa Rica in the 06 World Cup that like really sealed the deal for me. So Philipp Lahm, emotional reasons, quality reasons, versatile, amazing, probably the best right back I've ever seen play.
He was a fantastic player, to be fair. Like, as much as being having it ingrained in you to dislike Germany for all of your life, especially your formative years in the 90s with football, watching him play, he was a fantastic right back. Germany captain, Bayern Munich captain.
That's right. Yeah, after Balak retired, he became the captain for Germany. And like I said, he was so good that Pep moved him around because Pep saw like skill sets and was like, I can play this guy anywhere.
Yeah, nice little personal choice as well for you as well. Like that. Chuck, what about you?
Well, I kind of went similar, so kind of out there, but I couldn't overlook the player who is the most decorated footballer of all time in terms of trophies won.
Okay, there's definitely going to be some crossover. Danny Alves.
Danny Alves!
I fucking hate him. So much. My blood is boiling that the two of you just brought that up. Even that, like, hate that guy. Go ahead, take your 1 minute to make a case.
No. This that yours will be way more interesting.
Well, we like mid-2000s to, you know, culminating in 2012, Chelsea and Barcelona had quite a few encounters with each other and a whole lot of beef.
Oh, there was that horrific game where literally everything went against Chelsea.
Yeah, there should have been about 9 penalties.
Jesus. And the rest.
Just the most atrocious refereeing. Like, unbiased. Obviously biased. I literally punched a wall that day and busted a knuckle. I was so angry. It was like the 2 days before my 21st birthday. And it almost ruined the whole week. But also, like, from an unbiased perspective, everyone has to see that and think that that was, like, one of the worst officiating ever. But Danny Alves was smug and violent. And if he had been a Chelsea player, he would have been one of my favorites, but he was not a Chelsea player, so...
There you go. Yeah, the self-awareness is strong with you, at least.
Yeah, for sure. I fucking hated that guy so much.
I take it. I mean, he's won everything. Like, it's,
sure.
Weirdly, I thought he was part of a World Cup winning squad, but never won the World Cup. Won the Copa America twice. He won the treble with PSG, which isn't really saying
but
much.
But that's it, the level of success at every club he was at.
Won everything at Juventus, did well at Valencia. Obviously, Barcelona goes without saying. And 4-0 trophies. Like, that's not even personal accolades. Just to be a part and a stalwart and a main part of those trophies.
Does he have more trophies than Messi?
Everyone.
That's crazy. That's crazy. That is pretty cool.
I mean, it's because he's then gone, you know, he's done a couple of seasons at the French, in the French league. And whatever. Yeah. But even still.
Gets your average up, doesn't it?
Well, that's what I do. It's all about bumping up those numbers. Otherwise, they're rookie numbers. And now he's moved into a more of a midfield role and he's got a free role. I'm pretty sure he's now at Sao Paulo or something. And he's said in interviews, like, he just gets to do what he wants.
Yeah.
And when you're so good and you are in your late 30s, you know, that's like, you know, that's when players go to the MLS normally. But
Yeah. Right. Well, I think that's Alves then, isn't it? I'm afraid.
Come on. Do we get a veto? Can I get a veto in there somewhere? Is each of us allowed?
You know what? I'm going to go Philip Lahm.
Yay!
How does that work?
I'm going to go because, Ian, quite frankly, we're going to agree on tons of these.
Yeah.
We might do. We've not shown each other. I'm surprised.
I'd like to use up my credits for later.
Oh, I see.
And Philip Lahm, like, I can get on board with that.
He's a great choice. Yeah.
He's a fantastic player. So, at right back, starting.
Philip Lahm. Okay.
Mr. Lahm. Right. So, we're going through the middle now. Centre backs. The first name that comes to your head when you talk about centre backs is Paolo Maldini. That's
nice. Yeah. It. Yeah.
I'd be there. There's personal reasons for whatever, and you can make, especially like with centre backs and Oscar, you can go on about Chelsea players. Obviously, I love centre backs that maybe haven't achieved so much in their lives, but
I wonder why that is.
Yeah, I don't know. But when you play at one of the most famous, prestigious, high achieving clubs in world football for 24 years and 132 days. And that's not becoming a bit part player. That is going from like right back, left back in your youth career to being a centre back, to having the greatest centre back partnership between yourself and Baresi, and then going on to play with other players as well. From 1984 to 2009, like, huge changes in football.
Changes.
Ah, oh, fuck you. And third place in the Ballon d'Or twice. Like, it's Paolo Maldini. Paolo Maldini, the one everyone wants to be as a defender.
Yeah, he's not one that I got to... I probably saw him a couple of times in the Champions League before, like, when I was, you know, 2 years into my soccer fandom and barely aware of people's names at all. Actually, I'm barely aware of people's names now, so forget about back then. But he is one that I've seen on like every list of like best defenders of all time. And from what I can tell, was generally a pretty nice guy and got along with everyone.
And he's a stunning man.
Is he? I don't know anything about him other than the name.
Oh yeah. He's beautiful. I mean, his dad played for Milan. Like it's not often you hear with football the same thing in American sports, that a great player leaves and they retire the number.
Yeah.
So he wore the number three. Milan retired the number three. And the only person who's ever allowed to wear the number three would be his son or grandson or something.
Oh, that's so cool. You know what? I'm on board with this. This is awesome. But just for that alone.
You just thought of him when you thought of Italian defenders. And when in the 90s, when Italian football was fashionable and successful, and a lot of it was to do with its defense, you know, its defensive setup. And Maldini was just so reliable, and yeah, like everything just fits with that. So it's a great choice, hugely. That definitely. Yeah.
There's so many records he's got. Like,
yeah,
they went. There was one World Cup where they went 518 minutes without conceding.
That's
and
crazy.
Like, they didn't win the World Cup. That's what's incredible. They never won. He never won anything with Italy.
Yeah.
It was like runners up in third place or whatever in that great era, kind of like the England golden generation that didn't happen. But they came second in a World Cup and only conceded 2 goals.
That's insane. Yeah, that is insane.
So all go right up against that if you want.
Stimmers, who do you have for centre back? Your first centre back?
Cool. Do I go for my shithouse or my slightly more cultured one now?
Well, I mean, I've done the most cultured.
You have, haven't you? So I'm not... Okay, I'll go shithouse. Sergio Ramos.
Oh, that's a good one.
So,
Mr. Red Card himself.
Well, exactly. I mean, an amazing defender, but an even better
when
shithouse.
When he's on pitch.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You know, strong tackling, pacey, got, you know, incredibly fast.
Just don't let him hold a trophy, though.
No, quite. <yeah. laughs> Loads of international caps for Spain. He's played for Real since 2005. And yes, the most red and yellow cards in nearly every competition he plays in. But respected by all of his fellow professionals as an absolute c***. Yeah,
that's what's mad. The fact that they could go to Spain and like the centre-back partnership is Ramos and Pique. Like it's Barcelona, Real Madrid. But it just works. Like, it's absolutely fine. They'll beat the shit out of each other 1 week in an El Clasico.
Yep.
And then go win a World Cup, a Euros.
Yeah.
Sorry, a Euros, a World Cup, another Euros. Like,
yeah, I mean, it's hard not to respect the man, to be honest. If you were playing against him, it'd be an absolute fucking nightmare. But yeah, Sergio Ramos. Oscar?
Well, I'll go with my, you know, shithouse pick out there, and it'll be a surprise to literally zero people. The greatest centre back in the history of England, the one, the only, John Terry. No. I mean, what do I need to say other than he's John Terry? Like, England's brave.
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, let's face it, if we're going four at the back here, like, we can put all six forward and choose two.
Yeah, that's true. JT, the most goals as a defender. JT, the most trophies as a central defender. JT, the most assists as a central defender. The most captain of armband as a central defender. The most, I don't know. The list goes on and on and, most, on and on and on.
Just the most.
Just the most.
Yeah.
Just the most, you know, wives as a central defender. And in his day, unstoppable. Just unstoppable. Like, just, I've never, I think, in any sport seen someone lock down a defense the way he did. He knew exactly where to be. His lack of physicality, or rather his lack of pace, even earlier in his career, was never an issue. He always found a way to organize himself and the players around him. He was the captain for all captains, and everyone that isn't a Chelsea fan fucking hated him. And that's exactly
what you want. That's what you want.
That's what you look for in a player, yeah.
Yeah, you know a player's good when everyone hates them and the people on your own team love him to death.
Yeah.
Gotta be JT.
Right, let's do what Chuck said, and let's go around again and then pick our two from
that. Well, my other one is Vincent Kompany. Always liked him. Not a Chelsea player, but I've mentioned this a few times. I feel a kindred spirit with City fans and with Manchester City as the two, you know, newly rich oil clubs that people love to hate in the Premier League. And he's a, you know, just like a classy dude. They're basically the opposite of JT.
Yeah.
In that everyone respects him.
The balance always works really well, especially like with centre-back partnerships. You've got the one who's going to go out and get the ball.
Yeah.
Who is just an absolute fucking animal. And then you've got the other one who knows exactly what's going on and has to rein that one in. And that other person in themselves has to be so fucking strong. The fact that the absolute renegade maverick can be controlled by them.
Exactly, yeah. And Kompany's City team in 2012, you know, within a week of each other was the Aguero goal and Drogba's header in Munich. And those two, like that City team was exciting in the same way that I have felt for a lot of Chelsea teams, where I was like, everyone hates them. Everyone assumes that Man United is going to win and fuck Man United. And then they just, like, it was like a great Cinderella story to see them come back that way.
It was
like
joining, like, a union of the different disenfranchised groups of hatred towards Man United. Because it wasn't even like you're a Liverpool fan or you're a Man City fan and you hated United. Just everyone in the 90s hated United. Just everyone. Because there was the beef with Arsenal for quite a few years. There was just the fact that it had gone on for so long. And there's something about seeing a Goliath toppled and the fact that they were celebrating, you know, they were celebrating on the pitch at Old Trafford because the game at Old Trafford ended.
It was over.
Less than 20 seconds before Aguero scored. Like, it's no time. Like, they're all running out and trying to start to celebrate. And then Ferguson checks his watch and starts looking at the screen and you see, like, a panic in his eyes. And then the news came round. Like, I still remember where I was when that happened, is I was at my ex-girlfriend's parents' house and she'd gone off with her nan because they were massive Man City fans to go watch it at her nan's house, and everyone else that I was with were United fans. And so I watched kind of the last 20 odd minutes of the game and I popped my head out because City equalised. I popped my head out and just went, oh, just so you know, City have equalised, blah, 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 blah. And they were like, yeah, it doesn't matter, it doesn't matter. Came back in, sat, watched Aguero, came back and went, City have just won the league, and all of them out the garden like, fucking what? Like, boom, boom,
boom. That's amazing.
And it was fantastic. And yeah, company, like we've spoken about it so many times, like they miss that player.
They really do.
Blighted yeah. so much by injuries though.
And there's something about an emotional leader who is also a defender that is really hard to replace. I'm firmly in the camp that a center back should be the captain. Because they have that ability. They see everything happening in front of them and they can calm everything down. But also, and to go back to JT for a second, he, when we needed that oomph, that push, he would drive the ball from his own box to the edge of the other box and then lay a pass. And that's why he like underrated with his Hollywood passing, with his assist and his creativity. And company has that too. I think of his goal last year, 2 years ago, where he just bombed forward and then smashed it from the edge of the box. And like how important that ability to both calm down and or rile up and agitate when necessary a captain at center back has. And I think company is just as much of a leader that was vital to their success as JT is, and both Chelsea's defense and City's defense, since those two guys have been out of the picture, are massively suffering for.
And also, he's got a master's in business admin, so he can take care of all of the business side of your team. This 11, you know. He's thought about the future. Right there, Chuck?
Yeah.
You like that one?
No, I didn't see where that was going. Okay. Oh, good.
Stimmers, who's your second?
My second one is Rio Ferdinand.
Oh. Rio was going to be one of my honourable mentions.
Okay. Oscar immediately reacted with disgust. But come on, listen. This guy, he twice broke the transfer record and he proved he was worth it. He won 14 trophies over his career. I've picked him because he's more finesse than most English defenders. He was comfortable with the ball at his feet. He got criticised a lot early on for taking risks and stuff, like a lot of like young defenders, like I'm thinking of John Stones and stuff like that do.
Yeah.
But Rio really grew into that side of his game and knew when to take risks, knew what to do with it. And he became a really cultured, almost sort of continental central defender with the ball at his feet.
But he was the same. He was a leader, man. You felt like Vidic was the one who was just, you never knew what the fuck was going to happen. But I think you can definitely, you know, Oscar, if you're going to group company with Terry, I'd group Rio in the same thing.
Yeah, no, that's
and
fair.
It's a lot of this is hard because you're putting aside personal feelings. Because again, like, hey, the Man United team. Hey, that England team caused a lot of heartache as well, like throughout the years. But
I don't think Rio was even the best defender at United, though. You mentioned Vidic. I think if I'm putting together a team,
it's not a best 11,
and I'm removing bias completely because I would never pick a Man United player. But if I was forced to, I think I would take Vidic over Ferdinand.
It's not a best 11, though.
Vidic was the better defender there.
Not a best 11. This is our favourite players for whatever reason.
Fine.
We choose. And it was just nice to have a more cultured English defender when English football, especially sort of like late 90s, early 2000s, was sort of criticised as being
rough and ready.
One-dimensional. Yeah, exactly. And it was just nice to get a centre defender who could put his foot on the ball, take it past someone, figure out what to do with it, and then spray a pass out without just fucking lumping it up to a baggy-shirted Michael Owen. But, you know. So, yeah, I accept that he will not be the best defender on this list. I mean, you know, he cannot compare to Maldini for talent, or I accept that. But as an English defender, I always liked him, and so I thought I'd pair him up with Ramos.
Yeah.
Okay, well, that kind of means that with my one, we've got, I mean, everyone's modern, obviously, like we said before, but my one that was kind of like a, when you just watch someone play and the impact they have on the team and the calming influence and reading of the game, you know, mine were quite similar, especially as I built the rest of my team and realised I was kind of playing in a 4-0-6 with incredibly attacking fullbacks. So, you know, the structure element came into it there that I went, right, who would you want? You've got to have Maldini. And I put Virgil van Dijk as my other
I thought about putting
back.
Him over company, yeah.
Yeah, that's a good choice. He's so easy to like.
He's so easy to like. He's a giant of a man, but so agile. And the fact, I think the fact is that when the press or whoever or us make such a huge, big deal of like one mistake that a player makes, you'd know that they are just the nuts.
Yeah, yeah.
You watch him go around the pitch, and people will say about Zidane gliding around the pitch, etc., and looking like when he's got the ball at his feet, whatever. But Van Dijk just, he never seems to run anywhere. And the game of football now is so fast and so quick. And he's had, like, Dejan Lovren next to him for a long time. And, like... He's got Trent Alexander-Arnold on the other side, who, yes, he's an incredible assister, but fuck me, he can't defend for
missing.
Shit.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's had, you know, he's had to deal with Adrian behind him. Like, he's had shit thrown at him, and he's just an incredibly calm, incredibly likeable, from that rich Southampton Academy Liverpool pipeline. I thought maybe you guys would say something that's a bit easy, or, you know, Oscar would say, well, he hasn't won a title yet.
No, he was actually almost my second pick, but I just, like, it was between him and Company, and I went for Company just because of the 2012.
Yeah.
May 2012, that great, great month when Avengers first came out, Aguero goal. This is like, it was my birthday and Avengers, then the week after... was Aguero, and then the week after was the Chelsea Champions League. Like, what a great month.
Golden period for you.
And you know, my other one was going to be, like, Koulibaly, but that was a bit hipster, and I haven't watched him a lot, but it was the same thing, just that kind of calmness and control. And when, you know, I loved, there was the Napoli-Liverpool game. I don't even know if it was this season or last season now, like, because of the break in football. It's blank, but it was such a nothing game, but it was just a complete battle of defenders. It was just attackers trying to break down these elite defenders. And it was just such an incredible watch, especially being neutral, to see the kind of the negative, inverted commas, massively negative side of the game, of just stopping stuff from happening as opposed to making stuff happen. But I just think Van Dijk, in my years of watching football, it's a defender he's incredible, incredible.
All right, so how do we decide this? Vote for two that aren't your own and then see if there's any overlap?
Maybe. That's so tricky.
So just as a reminder for everyone listening at home as well, so we had Sergio Ramos, Paolo Maldini, John Terry, Vincent Kompany, Rio Ferdinand, and Virgil van Dijk. So Ian, if you had to pick two. So yeah, let's go with what Oscar said. You have to pick two that are not your own.
Van Dijk, just like you say, so rarely makes a mistake, but then that means if I was to go Van Dijk and Company, I'm ignoring Maldini, who is just the consummate defender. It's just
ignoring the best defender in the history of the Premier League, I guess. Just not even going to consider him.
I nearly chose John Terry myself as well. It just shows how tricky this is. I think I will go for Maldini and Company.
Okay, Oscar, you're two.
Well, I can't vote for Maldini because I don't remember ever seeing him play, right? So, like, that would... Although I'm inclined to, just because of everything I've heard, right? But, like...
Of course, yeah.
Taking that kind of out of the equation just for, like, personal experience reasons, I think I'm going to go with Van Dijk because he almost made my two. Mm-hmm. And... Sergio Ramos, because I just love that he threw the trophy under the bus. It cracks me up. It's like my favorite thing to happen that has nothing to do with soccer, but is soccer related.
You know, I'm happy that both of mine got a vote, first of all. So, happy days. And, you know what, I'm happy to go with the other two that got the votes. And, you know, for me, it's weird because the two I nominated aren't going to get in at all. But I'm happy to go with Ramos and Company as a centre-back pairing.
Nice.
All right. I can live with that.
So I think we can go with that. So let's put that in. We'll put in Ramos.
For the record, Chuck, I think that's harsh on you because both your choices were great. That is harsh. But
Yeah. I almost voted for Maldini, but I can't vote for him.
Fair enough. Like, like we say, this isn't necessarily the best or anything. I don't really know what this is, but we're gonna come up with an 11.
Something? Yeah. Is this something? I think it's something.
Who knows? But to round it off, and I mean, I'll go first here because I think Ian will probably have the same. Like, did anyone else put Roberto Carlos at left back?
Oh, yeah, I did. But I've got another one, if not.
That's fine. It's kind of the same reasons as Dani Alves. but just a bit nicer than maybe, judging by what Oscar said. he did. He won the World Cup, Real Madrid for all that time. As a left back, like he came second in the Ballon d'Or.
Yeah, it's incredible.
His nickname was the Bullet Man. he had a free kick recorded at 105 miles per hour.
Unbelievable.
And his thighs were 24 inches. He was like 5 foot six. He scored the iconic, like you think of free kicks.
Oh, yeah.
You think of him running up and with the outside of his left boot hitting it and his right foot going so high above his head. And Fabian Barthez just standing there with his mouth open, not knowing what the fuck was going on in Le Tournoi, which was in 1997, and England won that tournament. It was a mini tournament. England, France, Brazil, Germany. And we fucking won it. Happy days. But Roberto Carlos made that position, the attacking left-back assister, incredible contributor up front. That's my suggestion.
I can get behind that. Ian, was that your pick also?
It was my pick, yeah.
Yeah,
I mean almost for that free kick alone.
Yeah,
when,
exactly.
Like...
Yeah. I'm fine with that.
It shouldn't work.
No.
Science.
No, the physics is insane on that thing.
There were years in the playground where it was everyone was trying to do.
But that what was funny
Roberto
as well,
Carlos.
I mean, I don't even know what boots he wore, but like Predators came out in like 94, 95, something like that. I was about 10, 11, I think. And like, you know, to think about you were obsessed with this idea of like curling the ball. And then I think that free kick was 97.
It was 97.
Right.
Yeah.
And it was just like, yeah, like you say, seeing him do that with a ball, then you were just like, right, I need to get some Predators and I need to get out in the garden and just do as many free kicks.
Oh, I would have just hung up my shoes forever after that. I'd be like, nope. Just, that's
fair
it.
Enough.
Yeah. Clearly, I'll never be able to do that. That's the greatest free kick of all time, right? Like, it just is.
Undoubtedly.
Yeah.
I was six when that happened, and I remember watching it live.
Yeah, it's the sort of moment that makes you fall in love with football, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
You watch it
really
back
is.
Years later, and you see the ball's going right. You're like, he's fucked it. It's never coming back from here. It just comes back, and you're like, yeah, but it's going to get close. Like, maybe come close. Oh, it's going to maybe hit the side netting. No, that's it. Shit.
It's insane.
It feels like it bends so late as well.
He's like 35 yards out. It's like, Oscar, you mentioned the physics. Like, I'm pretty sure they've done things where they're like, this shouldn't work.
Yeah. Is it like how a bumblebee flies or whatever that no one knows?
Yeah,
exactly. They're like, maybe Newton was wrong. We should have Roberto Carlos.
Newton should have put on a pair of fucking Predators is what Newton should have done.
I'm pretty sure he's my dad's favorite ever player, too. I think I remember that, so I'm not even going to bother bringing up Ashley Cole. Like, it's clearly
actually,
Roberto Carlos.
I was going to say, we'll go honourable mentions then.
Yeah.
Dennis Irwin?
Ian, you're not even getting a yes from me, and Oscar's never heard of him, so...
Correct, yeah. That is correct.
One for the teenagers.
So, shall we go for... do you want to mention Crystal Palace, Loney, Ashley Cole?
I mean, you know, what is there to say? He shot a trainee with a BB gun. Yeah. He left Arsenal to win trophies.
We've already touched on that as well, about having to leave Arsenal to win something.
So, yeah, no, I mean, Chelsea fans know. Non-Chelsea fans don't want to hear me talk about Ashley Cole for the next 20 minutes about how he's amazing.
Palace got loaned him in 2000, and he was fantastic. He didn't play for a long time, but it was from that he got the chance to play for Arsenal, really. Like, that got him the minutes.
See, I didn't even know that. That's cool.
And he said for a number of years that he would, like, he'd like to go back there at some point, almost as like a thank you.
Mm-hmm.
But then he went to America like a fucking prick.
To the LA Galaxy, yeah.
But I said, well then, so Roberto Carlos.
Yeah, I'm totally fine with that. I remember him, and obviously I don't remember very many players before 2006, but I remember him at World Cups and being like, what the fuck is this guy? All right, so let's move on to midfield.
There's a player when I did this that I thought that all three of us would have.
Yeah, I can assume... that you're about to say, the one, the only.
The one, the only, OBE, MLS All-Star, author of 20, that's right, 20 children's books. It's super Frank Lampard.
Yep. Soon to be greatest Chelsea manager of all time. Literal certified genius.
And as much as I wanted to write this and troll you, Oscar, I couldn't not write Frank Lampard down because I just...
No, he's the best central midfielder, full stop.
Ian's silence is worrying me here, that he wasn't even close to putting him in. You went Gerard, didn't you?
Not gone for him.
Ian, honestly, I expected to be attacked by Chuck with an anti-Chelsea bias here. And Ian keeps suggesting Man United players. He didn't even vote for John Terry. Like,
no one's voting for John Terry, mate.
What you've got to understand is I grew up in the, you know, my main sort of football period was in the late 90s, early 2000s. So Man United were
the evil
dominant.
Ones.
Yeah, but they were dominant. And it was, you know, it was impossible not to sort of be impressed by it. And, you know, I used to love like the grudge matches between Arsenal and Man United. They were absolutely insane. So, yeah, it's a tricky one. I probably have got more Man United players than you two would like.
But I tell you what, on Lampard, because Oscar, you can go down the emotion route. Let me just churn out the stats. So I had mentioned MLS All-Star.
Yeah.
The one they all want to win. He genuinely has written 20 children's books, which I just thought was mental. I never even knew that whatsoever.
Yeah.
He's won the Premier League 3 times. He's won the FA Cup 4 times. He's won the Champions League. He came second in the Ballon d'Or to Ronaldinho. He is 5th all-time for Premier League goals. He is 4th all-time for Premier League assists. As a midfielder... And he scored the goal that meant the introduction of goal line technology. Even though he didn't score it, but he fucking scored it and should have counted. And he also scored the penalty that is the one moment that I cannot watch within football without fucking crying just after his mum died.
Yeah.
And put that fucking penalty away. And it's like one of the most emotionally charged, incredible moments. And now I'll just let Oscar go on how great he is.
Well, you also forgot to mention the 7 seasons in a row, I think it was, that he got 20-plus goals as a central midfielder. That's pretty impressive, I think. Not to linger too long on him, obviously, but like from the emotional perspective, that moment lives in Chelsea history for forever and ever and ever. When, you know, that penalty against Liverpool for the Champions League right after his mom, and he just goes down and he drops to his knees. Like, I was in a bar in Manhattan in New York City called Nevada Smith's. It was like the soccer bar in America, the biggest soccer bar in America for a long time until it got shut down for selling to underage people, one of whom was me. I used to go with my brother's ID. And just like openly sobbing a room full of grown-ass people when he scored that goal. And like that connection to strangers in a bar, to Chelsea fans all around the world in that moment is still to this day like one of the more powerful sports things, other than obviously like elation when your team wins a trophy, your team wins a title. Like, it's that, and it's the first game after 9/11 in New York City that are like the big, you know, in my mind, the biggest emotional sporting things where you're like, oh, sport really does transcend itself sometimes. And Lampard, that moment is one of those handful. Every few years you get a like, wow, this means a lot to a lot of people more than just 20 guys kicking a ball around. And so, yeah, from the emotional perspective, you can list accolades forever and ever and ever. But yeah, I mean, I think that Michael Ballack is my favorite ever player, but Frank Lampard is my favorite ever Chelsea player, if you know what I mean. Because I like Ballack outside of a Chelsea context, and that he was the reason I came to Chelsea.
Yeah.
But just as Chelsea, like, no one touches Lampard. No one. Not Drogba, not Terry, not Cech, not Ashley Cole, not Gianfranco Zola, even for the older players. Forget about Eden Hazard. He doesn't even get mentioned in this conversation. Like, Lampard is the be-all and end-all. And that's why when they brought him back, like, you know, a lot of outside fans are like, oh, he's not better than Sarri, oh, he's not blah, blah, blah. It's like, yeah, but he's Frank Lampard. Like, he is Chelsea. And he gets infinite amount of slack from us. Hopefully that doesn't... those words don't come back to bite me in the ass 2 years from now. But like,
I mean, thank God it's not being recorded so that it could. Yeah.
I might be like, they should fire him as a manager for like reasons, but I will never, ever have anything but pure and unfiltered love for Frank Lampard.
I find it very hard to hate Chelsea out of spite to piss you off with him as manager. Like, we're in this outside time now where, because we're not caught up in the season and we're not in the kind of maelstrom of it, that we're just being a bit nicer. I mean, we're just being nicer to people in general. Like, yeah. When we ask how someone is, we actually give a fuck and want to listen to the answer. But, yeah, Frank Lampard, it's the more you think about it, like, he was just always there. He was a consummate professional. Yeah, like you said, he's got all the wins.
Of him going to, like, youth training as a player, he would, like, train for an hour extra and then go to, like, youth matches. Like, not as a coach, not as an – like, what fucking player is going to, like – the under 14 matches just to like put an arm around the kids and be like, listen, this is Chelsea and we are all Chelsea. Like, and him and JT used to do that. And just, yeah, I don't know. We can move on.
I can't remember the exact, and just like something that might get missed as well. Like, obviously we spoke about his goal scoring and, you know, him being a midfielder and it'd be ridiculous because he was just box to box and everywhere. But I think for his time with Chelsea in the Premier League, he scored against every single team that existed in the Premier League during that period. Because when he moved to Man City, the last one to get was, of course, Chelsea.
And he scored against
them. Which he did. And the fact that he was such a huge part of Chelsea. And it's one of the few times where it's like not celebrating against your old club. Like, you get it. Right. Yeah, when someone's been somewhere for 3 months, 12 years ago, and they go, oh, no, can't, fuck off, just celebrate. It's different now, but like you could buy it and respect it. And it shows how professional he was, that he would still just smash that ball in. That I think it basically won City the title that year.
It was I don't remember exactly what it was, but I remember it was a really important goal, both to City and against Chelsea. And I remember not even being mad about it, being like, well, of course, like, okay. I wouldn't want it any other way. I'm honored to have been scored on by Frank Lampard. Like, yeah.
Ian, do you want to do some players?
Not really. Just kind of... I feel like I can almost throw one of mine away, and I'm sort of fairly happy with that.
I mean, Frank Lampard's in. I don't care what you say. Like, I've already written it down. I mean, it is in pencil. But unfortunately, mate, I don't own any rubbers. So
yeah, set in stone. Yeah, no, that's fine. We can definitely put Lampard in. So then we've got three more midfielders. So who wants to start for the next one?
You, mate. Come on.
Yeah, it's your turn.
Who do I go with then?
Oscar needs time to recover to build up to another go.
Yeah.
Like, I just relieved him of...
Absolutely.
I caught him off guard. The surprise. Okay. The stranger, I believe they call it.
I'll go Paul Gascoigne.
Yes!
I figured he was going to be here for years. Yeah,
it's impossible not to. It's just, the man was so creative on the ball. His range of passing was unbelievable, but because often he had a bit too much meat on his bones, also he had a physical presence, like you couldn't bully him off the ball. He was a great tackler. He just had everything. He just pulled everyone around him up to not quite his level, but, you know, he pulled them all along with him. And, I mean, he was just something else. And we mentioned the England-Scotland game in Euro 96. And
the one where he did coke off the line?
No,
that was Robbie Fowler. I always think that.
This is the raging alcoholic.
The dentist chair.
Yeah, the dentist chair celebration. Yeah, the flick over, it was Hendry, wasn't it? And then...
It was over Hendry, yeah, the ball from Anderton.
Yeah.
That's what's so beautiful, because it was after the day... So it's all the things that had to happen for that goal to be great.
Yeah.
Like, if David Seaman doesn't save that penalty, that goal doesn't happen.
90 seconds before, yeah, absolutely.
If that, he saves the penalty that goes out for the corner.
Yeah.
Scotland take it in and it gradually gets cleared. The ball comes out to Anderton. Anderton plays it over to Gascoigne with his left foot first touch, flicks it over Hendry. The ball's still in the air and he just hits it. Bottom left corner, past Andy Gorham. It's just precise.
Finesse volley, like it's not sort of powered. It's just, yeah.
And the celebration afterwards and the reason why, like it was the dentist chair because they're out drinking, etc. The commentary 5 minutes before, fuck, because this game was on the other day and I watched it. The commentary about 5 minutes before that, the commentator says pretty much word for word, Gascoigne's going to be really disappointed because he hasn't really contributed here. And you're like 3-4 minutes later, he's scoring a goal that 24 years later, is still the go-to, if you say think of an England goal, It is that?
Yeah, absolutely. On home soil against Scotland after a disappointing game against Switzerland where we hadn't really done anything. Yeah, it was so important, that goal. It was, and after, like you say, after Seaman's save as well, when it could have been so different. But yeah, also with Gazza, it's all about the legend, because he genuinely was a footballing genius, and you get that eccentricity that always comes with someone who's like a creative genius. And you get, there's a million different stories that you get with Gazza, isn't there, about, you know, and some of them in light of the alcoholism and stuff aren't necessarily particularly funny, but then there's just the personality of the guy.
I mean, one of the first things when he went to Lazio, one of the first things he said to the owner of the club, I won't attempt to do the Italian because I can't quite get it, but he saw him, went to him and went, hey, in Italian, your daughter, massive tits.
Jesus Christ. His Italian was notoriously terrible as well, so I bet a lot of that was in the actions.
Fans of Lazio loved him because he punched reporters. He belched down microphones in interviews. Like, he was...
I would watch a documentary about this guy, because every single time he comes up, you guys could tell me anything, and I'm like, are they fucking with me, or is this real? But it must be real. And also, I didn't even know he was that good at soccer, because you guys are so, you know, you talk about like the legend and the myth of the man. Like, I knew he was good. I didn't realize he was like...
He was one of those players that he was... And it will always be said as he was just a naturally incredible footballer. Like, he could just... Yeah. He wasn't a workmanlike player. He wasn't structured. No. It was just, if you put the ball at his feet, like, he could just do incredible things. And he didn't play for amazing clubs at amazing times. You know, he was Newcastle, Tottenham, yep. Lazio, Rangers was where he probably got the most accolades. But on the flip side, obviously, you had that, and throughout his career, he had big problems with depression and alcoholism and suicidal. And he was fucking vilified in the press, like he was destroyed, like his. He had Euro 96 where he was incredible, and then he should have been at Euro 98, the 98 World Cup. But the only reason he got dropped was because the press put a load, but the night before the team selection was completely finalised, they put up a load of pictures of him from however long ago, like eating kebabs in the evening. And then Glenn Hoddle, the manager, was just like, well, I'm not going to pick him now because of how the press will respond or whatever. And it destroyed him. It completely did.
That's really
fucked up. It was really, something about him would make an incredible documentary, because he was an incredibly, incredibly talented guy. And on the flip side of it, like he battled and still does battle with a hell of a lot of demons. But in terms of iconic England players, like, there's a hell of a lot of love. It's a hell of a lot of love. But what's another one? Give us your other one, because otherwise we're going to get stuck on this stuff for hours and hours and hours.
Another one then. I'll go completely different, and I will go Ronaldinho, who's a player I mostly know from international exploits, and more specifically the 2002 World Cup, which was... Japan and South Korea, wasn't it?
Yeah, when he knocked England out.
When he knocked England out,
Germany lost in the final.
Yeah, so. Him, Ronaldo, and Rivaldo were just incredible to watch in that tournament. I mean, sickening to watch if you're talking about that quarter final.
But they came back in a big way after 98, like they had to.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, what was the free kick against Seaman? It must have been like what 40 yards out.
40 yards out on the right, the near side.
Yeah, completely took Seaman by surprise. Mm. I, you know, you talk about sort of personal moments, whatever, although it was a bad one. Like, I was in a pub. All the pubs had opened early. That was a weird thing back then, you know, that pubs had given special licences to open early because you were watching games at like 8 o'clock in the morning or whatever. And I had to convince myself not to drown my sorrows and carry on drinking, because I had an A-level physics exam that afternoon. It was just sort of like, no, I've got to stop. But like, and then they played, I can't remember whether it was BBC or ITV, but they played Oasis, Stop Crying Your Heart Out as the montage. And I could not listen to that song again without it being taken back to that moment. But Ronaldinho was just something else to watch that that game and that tournament.
So you've gone for two very mercurial, like,
yeah,
it just could do incredible things with the ball at their feet players.
Yeah, true. I said gone different. Maybe I was just talking purely from a nationality point of view. Yeah. But yeah, you're right. Absolutely.
And also someone who clearly battles demons and has
had a very
tumultuous post-playing career.
Mm. Yeah.
But I think the highest, well, not the highest, but to summarize Ronaldinho in, you know, a few words, he's a soccer player pre-2014, honestly, maybe 2010, that Americans know.
Gotcha.
Like, I can go up to a random baby boomer who is like, fuck soccer, that's for foreigners, and blah, 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 blah. And they're like, oh, Ronaldinho, yeah, that guy. I know that guy.
Oh, that's interesting.
The Brazilian guy.
Yeah.
He's like, his Nike commercials, his, like, there are just YouTube videos that everybody knows. Like, he transcends. He's so good that anti-soccer douchebag Americans are still like, wow, that guy's pretty cool, huh? And so, like,
yeah,
I mean, like, speaking of players that you can't help but love watching.
Yeah, I definitely have a soft spot for players where there's a cult of personality behind it.
Like, yeah, apparently. Yeah. And no, I'm a little overweight, too.
Yeah, I'm certainly realizing this.
Players that don't like training, players that don't like, you know, they love a drink, they love a party.
Yeah, look, I'm a Ronnie O'Sullivan man, not a Stephen Hendry man, all right?
All right, well, Chuck, do you have any center mids to throw into the mix here?
I mean, I just have one more. I mean, I had Gazza down and I could have put him anywhere. Like, let's not pretend that we're going to end up with any sort of cogent structure with this game.
Sure. Well, you did run out of 406, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, this is true. I think, again, I mean, I'm going to go honourable mention again for maybe, like, the best player I've seen live in a centre mid, which was in a game that ended up not really meaning anything. But Yaya Toure, on his day... watching him live was just incredible. Like, how he could just control a game, be there, not really put in much effort, but just do these incredible things, and then just banging a ball from 30, 40 yards. Like, it was just incredible to watch him and go for as long as he did with whatever clubs. But same team, different era, Kevin De Bruyne.
Yeah, good choice.
Yeah, that's a good shout. He's amazing.
I haven't seen... a player be able to pick out a pass like that, be able to, like, play from right in front of the defence, almost as a centre-back in front of two centre-backs, like, really weirdly, all the way up to playing as the centre-attacking mid, the main focal point throughout the whole central gut of the team, almost, and just be able to just run it and just go, like, I'm going to put the ball there. Like, not just, like, over there or in that little area. I'm going to put it on that blade of grass because that guy is currently running at 19.8 miles an hour. He's just taken a step off his left foot, which means that by the time he gets there, he'll be in his right foot. And all of this processes in his brain in a fraction of a second. And the ball flies perfectly. And you're like, how? Like, even at pace, around players going out from the wing and playing those balls that cut. He's, for me, he's the expert at playing the ball close enough to a defender that they think they have a chance, but far enough away that they do not. And so it means that they, rather than leaving it and then being able to potentially chase up, they do go for it. And then that's the extra step that the striker or the next player gets to then just clear it. And he's a little wizard. And I think he's never come close to winning the Ballon d'Or. He's won the domestic quadruple with City. You think maybe if he gets a European trophy, maybe he'll get in with a shout. But, you know, obviously living in the era of Lionel Messi and Cristiano Ronaldo as we do, it limits the spots. But I just think KDB, incredible, incredible, incredible player.
It's a great choice because, like, for neutral Premier League fans like me, players like that are just so important because they're so fun to watch. He just makes stuff happen all the time. And yeah, like you say, the sort of similar to Gazza in a way, his range of passing and the sort of the natural ability to make those calculations to just work it out, you know, it's just innate. is just, yeah, he's quite something. He's so fun to watch. Like, there's nothing worse than sort of, there's a reason why people tune in to those matches even when they're not Man City fans. And it's players like him, without a doubt. He's so, so talented that you just can't comprehend sort of what he's doing. So, yeah, he's so fun to watch. It's such a good choice. Yeah, really is good.
Yeah, absolutely. He was going to be straight into mine, but I didn't want to be accused of having an even larger Chelsea bias in there.
Does that count as Chelsea bias? I don't think that counts as Chelsea bias.
No? Okay.
Nah, well, you're all right.
He's very much an open wound also. I liked him, not to sound like a hipster, but I liked him before he was a Chelsea player because we had been linked with him for a couple of windows. And so I was like, oh, who's this kid that there's rumors about? I'll just throw on like a YouTube highlight reel or whatever. And then I saw him and I was like, oh, fuck. If Chelsea land this kid, and he was still playing as a left winger back then, and on his FIFA card, it, like, they switched what footedness he was from 1 year to another. So they couldn't even decide if he was left footed or right footed. And his crossing, which is, I think, underrated because he plays so central now.
Yeah.
His crossing as a kid playing in the Belgian league for either Ghent or Genk. I think Genk with a K. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think so.
Was ridiculous. And I remember when we finally signed him, and he was like a fucking 12-year-old when we signed him. Like, he wasn't a glamour signing that anybody knew about at all. But I remember running into the room to Emily and being like, we signed De Bruyne, we signed KDB. And she's like, who? I was like, oh, you'll see. I'm really excited, really excited.
You'll see, then, eventually, and then he played for the wrong team in blue.
I know, ugh. And he had one season. I love Mourinho. I will always love Mourinho. But the thing that I despise the most, or that I resent, I should say, the most, is the way that he drove out De Bruyne, Mata, Lukaku, and Salah less so because he just wasn't good when he was at Chelsea.
He wasn't good then.
No.
No, we gave him a shot and it didn't really work out. He got a decent amount of minutes, but De Bruyne had it. And he fucking had it from day one. And unlike so many of us were like, this kid is going to be the thing. And then just Mourinho decided, because he does that sometimes. But De Bruyne is it hurts to like watching him.
Yeah.
Ian, you talk about, sure, like, he's so fun to watch. He is the thing that neutral fans love.
Yeah.
It hurts me how much I love to watch him because he's so good and he was ours. Yeah, and he was ours, yeah, when he was like 12. And now he's gone. But so I, for a couple of reasons, I left him out of mind. But he is like just universally likable, at least in terms of his style of play and everything. So I definitely see that. I'll throw out three quick names because I love midfield generals. So all of my picks were just central midfielders. I have no wingers in mind. Yaya, you know. Again, free kicks, just a fucking behemoth physical presence in
he's
the center of the
so
pitch.
So strong.
So strong, yeah.
So strong.
Similarly, but for much, much, much more emotional reasons, Michael Ballack in there. Yeah. Literally the reason I'm a Premier League fan. Literally the reason I'm a Chelsea fan. He came from Bayern Munich to Chelsea right as the World Cup was happening in 06. He was Germany's captain. I was like, okay. Let's see these Chelsea guys. Do I like them or is it just like one guy but the rest of them suck?
Yeah.
Because I'm not going to sign up like as a fan choosing a sport that is thousands of miles away and barely on TV at the time.
Mm.
I'm not going to pick a team where there's one guy I like and then the rest of them are evil, either terrible or just not fun to watch. Like if he had gone to Stoke, I wouldn't be a Premier League fan. But he went to Chelsea.
Brilliant.
You know what I mean? Like,
yep.
and you know, for life. I'm married to Chelsea Football Club and it's Michael Ballack's fault. Or thank you, I guess.
Yeah, not,
the way I said
not
that.
Not fault, but yeah.
It's his fault. And then the one that got away. You know, everybody has that girl that is like, well, not really. But that idea of the one that got away is a thing. And that for me is very much Luka Modric. Because he like was all but signed for Chelsea. He refused to go to training. He like gave interviews. Not in English. He was smart enough to not do it in English, but he gave interviews talking about how excited he was to play for Chelsea really soon. And then, of course, Tottenham was like, no, never mind. We're not actually going to sell him. So, and you know, just picks out a pass on a blade of grass like nobody. And he was part of that very exciting young Tottenham squad when Bale was still there, too.
Yeah,
where
yeah.
Despite myself, I would watch them and enjoy watching them. And that was Tottenham.
Which is weird, because they're like, if thinking about it now, like, you're a Knicks fan. And so, like, Tottenham are very similar. Like, they've had some incredibly exciting players throughout the years that had the potential to do so much, and then they sell them all off and fuck it up again and again.
Yeah, but it's all about when you come in. Like, in 06, they weren't even on my radar. I came in with, like, I'm going to pick a team that is at least contending for a title, obviously, because why would I pick a scrub team that isn't even going to be on TV? Also, they would only have, like, 2 games a weekend on TV back then. I was like, I'm going to come in, I'm going to pick a team that's good, potentially winning trophies, will be on TV regularly, and hopefully from London, in case I go over there, I don't have to go to some northern shit town.
Fuck's sake.
Good to know, even back then, that was a concern.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, coming from New York, you know, I gotta be...
Fuck's sake.
Gotta be who I am. But yeah, I was like, if it's a London team, all the better, and I was between Chelsea and Arsenal, and thank fuck I chose Chelsea.
Yeah, good choice.
Yeah. So those are mine. Obviously, Lampard and Gaz. Do we want to pick a third, or do we want to go 4-4-2 with two wide players here?
Does it matter? I mean...
I would like it to be at least somewhat coherent, if I'm being honest.
Going by what we've said, and the players that we've all suggested so far as our midfielders, 4-3-3
okay.
kind of makes sense. So what we're kind of left with here, so if we're saying Lampard, for sure, if we're going Gaza, for sure, which is great because finally I get two of my picks in, so that's good. We've got Kevin De Bruyne, Edgar Davids, Michael Ballack, Yaya Toure, and Luka Modric.
Okay. Now, I think, just for some semblance of reality then, I feel like Yaya Toure might be the best third choice, because we've gone very attacking with our other two midfielders.
Talk about not conceding goals, too. With our defenders and then Yaya in there in front of them? Fucking
yeah.
A.
Yeah.
That is shut down.
That to keep a semblance of reality, I feel like Yaya Toure is the way to go.
I mean, I'm fine with that. He was my pick. And Chuck, you said you almost picked him.
He was like my honorable mention. Like I said, okay.
All right. Bang in.
So
I figured Ballack was going to be a throwaway because no one else cares about him. Even among Chelsea fans, I like overly stan Michael Ballack.
Oh, it's like Michael Ballack. The two Mikes, Michael Ballack, Michael Essien, Michael Essien.
Oh, much love for Essien.
Big love for Essien. Okay, so at the minute we've been recording for about 2 hours now, and we're halfway through the team. So I think it's quite a good point to leave it there for next week, because we all know we need the content. But I'll go through it so far as our team. So in goal, we do have David Seaman. Yes. Right back, we're rolling with Philip Lahm. We've got Ramos and Kompany as our centre-backs. Roberto Carlos bombing down the left.
Sounds good.
And then a midfield three of Frank Lampard, Paul Gascoigne, and Yaya Toure.
That is mouthwatering. I'm really liking this so far.
Yeah, I really like it. Yeah, so what we got to sort out next week? Three strikers, wingers, that sort of thing.
Yeah, so I'm going to say it's... how lopsided do we... Do we just have three strikers? Do we just...
Might be.
It's going to be three left wingers. We're very one-sided.
Darren Anderton.
Or a number 10 and two strikers play like a 4-3-1-2.
Yeah. Okay, we'll give it some thought.
Potentially.
Yeah, let's get weird and FIFA with it.
And I think, just given how ridiculously long we've been recording, and for fear of poor Ian's editing, let's skip isolation recommendation station this week.
Yeah, it took so long for the train to come last week that I don't think we can handle it.
Yeah, it's running a little late.
A week late.
Yeah, we can tweet out some stuff. If you're really looking for some recommendations, obviously we are here to support everybody while they're on lockdown and whatnot. So if you're looking for stuff, we can tweet some stuff out. Otherwise, we'll save it for next week.
Yeah, definitely. We've got some good stuff for next week. We've got a few things to roll out, and it's good to talk about football again a lot.
Yeah, it's been
nice. You can tell it's been a while.
Yeah,
we're actually talking a lot.
I know. Yeah, it was like this was supposed to be like a half hour segment, and we're like 2 hours in.
Ian was genuinely worried before. He was just like, I've not got a lot to say.
He did literally say that, and then you were like, well, if we do 1 minute each.
We never had that problem.
No.
I don't know why I worry about it.
Us two. Like with the bluffer, Ian, just get out of our way.
But
we'll...
I also knew if I just went Gaza and then just sat back, Chuck would go,
I didn't even mention that Gazza, my mum says Gazza was my first word.
Exactly. Yeah.
There you go.
He couldn't not
I'm
be
just
in the
glad
team.
At least one Chelsea player got in there too. Because I was very concerned about like the blatant anti-Chelsea bias that was going
to
go on.
I think what we need to worry about is the anti-Peterborough bias. One ex-posh player, come on.
I mean, not even you.
Oh, I'm thrilled there's one ex-posh player in there.
You didn't even suggest
him. I know, I didn't suggest him.
I didn't think I had a chance. I wanted Bosnich.
Bosnich. Bosnich and Southall. That says everything about you and your aspirations in life. Thank you very much, gents, for recording. Oscar, say bye-bye.
Bye.
And Ian, say bye.
Bye-bye.
And we'll see you next week for the rest of our terribly unbalanced team. Take care, ladies and gentlemen. Goodbye.
Miles Offside is a Nate Whittam and Mark Howells production.